Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Gerry Oginski. I'm a New York medical malpractice and personal injury trial attorney. And today, I'm going to share with you some interesting information that's going to help you. And it's going to help you understand why, even though you are not a med mal attorney, why you're going to need the information I'm going to share with you. And if I were in your shoes right now, I'd be thinking, you know what? I'm coming to a Bridge the Gap CLE program. I'm going to sit on my laptop, play with my Facebook account on my iPhone, and, you know, just keep an open ear. Well, I'm going to share with you, you can do that, and that's cool. But if you pay attention to what I'm about to share with you this morning, what you're going to learn is going to remarkably change the way that you see opportunities in your own practice. And whether that practice is in bankruptcy, whether it's in transactions, real estate, I guarantee you by the end of my discussion this morning, you're going to gain an insight and an understanding into how communicating with your clients can turn you into the go-to resource for somebody who has key information that your clients need and want. Okay? So let me ask you this, and this is the best way for me to explain to you how this is going to come up. You know, everybody here is thinking, I'm not a med mal attorney. I don't need to know any of this. Let me give you a couple of ideas that is going to show you exactly how you're going to encounter people who think they may have something going on, and you, even though you don't practice medical malpractice, are going to start to ask questions in your own mind that maybe there's something here that might rise or give rise to a viable claim involving malpractice. So let me go through this one. You represent, well, you handle real estate transactions. And a young couple comes to you and they tell you, you know what? We're about ready to buy a home, our first home. We'd like you to do the closing. And you say, terrific. And you meet with Mr. and Mrs. Jones. And now they're going through the process, and 2 months later, it's now time for the closing. You arrive at the closing. Mrs. Jones is there. Her husband is nowhere to be seen. You ask her, where's your husband? Oh, well, he's in the hospital. He had a massive heart attack. Really, I'm sorry to hear that. What happened? Well, for the last 3 months, he'd been complaining of chest pain. He'd been going to his cardiologist, and his cardiologist brushed him off, said, don't worry, you don't have to worry about the chest pain. Just take some aspirin and you'll be fine. And the more you talk to Mrs. Jones, you begin to realize that something may have gone on there during the course of those 3 months when Mr. Jones was talking to his cardiologist that might indicate something may not have been done right. And Mrs. Jones is of the opinion that her young husband, who's now 37 years old, in the hospital, suffered a massive heart attack, that something might have been done to prevent this from occurring. So you, as a real estate attorney, are left with a question, what do you do next? How can you best help your client, who's coming to you to do a real estate closing, help them? How can you be a good resource for them so that you can show them you have information to help solve their legal problem? Because they may have one. Let's say, for example, you are a workers' compensation attorney, and a gentleman gets injured on the job. And now, as a result of a forklift falling over, injuring his arm, he goes to the hospital, and at the hospital, they have to sew up his massive gash. And during the course of sewing up in the emergency room, the doctor inadvertently sews up the nerve that controls the part of the arm and part of the fingers, and it's not recognized until about 3 weeks later that this gentleman has weakness in one part of his arm and has sensation decreased in the same part of the arm. And he learns after going to another surgeon that inadvertently, while sewing up the injury, they tagged the nerve that controls part of the arm. And unfortunately for him, he winds up having to need nerve transposition surgery, taking nerve from another part of his body, in order to try and fix it and add to his nerve that was damaged. Now he has a permanent injury to his hand, not from what occurred to him on the job, but rather from what occurred to him in the emergency room. So you're the workers' comp attorney, and he's coming to you for advice about his workers' comp case, and now you have to sit and ask yourself, what do I do now to help this guy? Because it sounds to me like there may be something here arising involving improper medical care in the emergency room. So as I continue on, you're going to get the sense that, hey, all these things about medical malpractice, I don't need to know. I'm going to tell you right now, during the course of your everyday activities, During the course of your career practicing law or working in a place where you are actively engaged in some type of law practice, you are going to encounter people every day simply by talking to them, learning from them, hearing them tell you stories about something that occurred in their lifetime. And now, you as the attorney, something triggers in your mind that says something doesn't sound right. How can I help them, and what do I need to do now in order to help solve what they're going through? So come join me as I share with you some other ideas of how this can come up. You're working in the office, your computer breaks down, you call the IT guy to come and fix your computer. And while talking to him, just in casual conversation, waiting for your computer to be fixed, you ask, how are things going? It turns out he's not having a good time lately. Why? Because he just tells you that his dad recently died of a massive blood clot. And again, you express your condolences, I'm sorry to hear that. And you don't know this guy. But just by talking to him, you find out that his dad went into the hospital to have a urological procedure done. And he was on anticoagulation medicine to prevent strokes. And in order to have the surgery, they had to remove him from that medication. And they were supposed to put him back on that medication right after the surgery to prevent any further strokes. And you ask, what's the problem? What happened? Well, for some reason, after Dad had the surgery, they forgot to put him back on the anticoagulation medicine. And it wasn't until 2 days later that somebody finally realized they didn't do it. And before they had a chance to give him that medication again, guess what? He had a massive stroke known as a saddle embolus, went to his lungs and killed him. And nobody knew why he died until an autopsy was done. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with what an autopsy is, it's an examination of a person's body after they have died by a doctor known as a pathologist, also known as a medical examiner. And during that examination, that post-mortem exam, they learned that he died from a massive stroke. And he had a burning question. Why didn't they give him the anticoagulation medicine sooner in order to try and prevent this exact thing from happening? So here you are, this guy's coming to fix your computer, and you ask yourself, what can I do to help this guy, even though you don't practice medical malpractice? Again, in the back of your mind, you are going to encounter these people every single day in your life and in your practice. And the real question is, what can you do to help solve their problem, or at least guide them to the people who can help? Let's say you do trusts and estates. You're called to the hospital to prepare a last will and testament. Somebody is dying, a not uncommon thing. And you go to the hospital, and what you find is shocking. You find that the person who's dying is 40 years old. She's dying of metastatic breast cancer. She's got 3 young children and a young husband. And now you go ahead and start drafting the will for her, and you learn from her that for 1.5 years, she had been complaining of a breast lump that she went to her gynecologist for. And the doctor kept blowing her off, nicely though, saying, listen, don't worry, it's a cyst, nothing to worry about, it's happening during your period. Come back, we'll check it every 6 months and see how you're doing for your routine GYN checkups. And that's what she did. She relied on her doctor. So what happened? Well, over time, before the next 6 month checkup, that lump diminished. And she forgot about it. And on the next visit, the doctor also forgot about it. And on the follow-up 6 months after that, forgot about it. Until suddenly, 1.5 years later, that lump regrew in the same exact place. And now all of a sudden, the doctor's frantic, sends the patient for a sonogram, a mammogram, a referral to a breast surgeon for a biopsy, and lo and behold, this woman has metastatic advanced breast cancer and is now dying. And here you are going in to do a last will and testament for this young woman. And you get the clear sense that something may have been done wrong, a failure to recognize or a failure to act to investigate what this particular thing was. What do you do now? Whether you handle bankruptcy or compliance or securities, what do you do? How about this scenario? Let's say you handle labor law and you get a call from a client, former client, who tells you, listen, my dad fell out of bed. He hit his head, he actually had lung cancer, went to the hospital to get treated, he was getting chemotherapy, and he hit his head, suffered a bleed in his brain known as a subdural hematoma. And as a result of that, he died 3 weeks later. What do you do as that labor law attorney with a former client who comes to you and says, I need help? Well, there are a couple things I'm going to share with you in just a few minutes that's going to show you exactly what you need to know in order to begin the evaluation process to talk and determine whether or not they may be a viable case here. How about this scenario? You handle business transaction disputes, or maybe transactional cases, and now you learn that one of your clients tells you about his mom who went in for a hernia repair. And during the course of a hernia repair, the doctors there injured the bowel. And during the course of that hernia repair, nobody recognized that the bowel had become injured. And 2 or 3 days later, his mom got worse and worse and worse, and ultimately died. Nobody knew why, until an autopsy was done. And during the course of that autopsy, it was revealed that there was an injury in the bowel, and the contents of the bowel were coming out into the abdominal cavity, where it should not have been, causing a massive infection known as sepsis. And because the sepsis, this massive infection, was not diagnosed and treated, this woman ultimately lost her kidney function, she lost all of her organs, and ultimately died. So what do you do in that scenario? How can you help this particular client? You're an attorney, right? You're trying to help these people solve their legal problems, and I don't care what area of law you practice. The most important thing for you to know as an attorney where somebody comes to you with a legal problem is, how can I help them? So let's jump right into it and talk about what is medical malpractice. Well, medical malpractice is medical carelessness, medical negligence, the carelessness of a medical professional. We say that if there's medical malpractice, that there are departures from good and accepted medical care. Okay, fair enough. Well, what elements do we need in order to make out a prima facie case? Well, I'll give you the simple answer. The simple answer is we need to show liability, causation, and damages. Well, if it were that simple, you know, it would be a lot easier to handle these malpractice cases. But let me go through with you and explain what it is that we need to do in order to evaluate, and something that you will need to keep in mind as you talk to these people who have these compelling problems. So I'm going to give you a key question that I ask every single caller who calls my office. And this will help you dramatically, because if you make the mistake of asking your potential client, tell me what happened, they are going to spend the next 45 minutes to an hour verbalizing and giving you a straight narrative that's going to go all over the map. And it won't help you identify the key issues you're looking for. Remember when you're studying for the bar exam? You have issue finding and fact finding. You're going to be doing the same exact thing when you evaluate whether or not somebody might have a case. So what are the key issues you need to look for? Before I share that with you, I want to share with you the key question that I ask that will help me immediately understand in just 2 sentences whether or not there may be a viable case here. So remember, we need to know the 3 elements, liability, causation, and damages. So rather than letting these concerned people tell us a story that's going to go on endlessly where they don't really know what we're looking for, what we need to do, and what I suggest you do, is ask them this one question. And contained within this one question are 3 elements. Okay, I'm going to go through it and then repeat it. What is it you think was done wrong, and what injury did you suffer as a result of that? Okay, let me go through it again. What is it you think was done wrong, and what injury did you suffer as a result of that? So what do you think was done wrong gives me a sense to find out from them whether or not there might be departures from good and accepted practice. Because I guarantee you that somebody is going to believe that something was done wrong here, no matter what. That's always the way it starts. But then, these people who are calling don't realize that there has to be that connection. There has to be a causal link between the wrongdoing and an injury. So we always ask, that caused, and what injury did you suffer as a result of that? What are the damages? And now, just within that one compound sentence, I've got a clear understanding of at least what they think is going on. Now remember, it's not always going to be accurate or thorough, but at least just in the first few moments of talking to them, I get a clear sense of what's happening and why. Why do you have this problem? Why do you have this resentment? Why this anger? Tell me more. Now I can follow up and ask key questions. So Keep in mind, that is a key question for you to ask to keep these people focused so that you don't have to sit there after a whole hour and finally start asking them questions. Now, what else do you need to know? Okay, we talked about the issue finding. What issues are involved in these malpractice cases? Most of these issues arise involving a commission, something done improperly, or an act of omission, something neglected, something not done. So they arise in a failure to diagnose, or an improperly performed surgery case, or something that was not done appropriately. So they have very strategic categories, but without even knowing or identifying what categories those are, let me put it for you in a different context. And here's a good way to explain it. Once you've identified that there's a problem, that somebody thinks or has a suspicion that there's some type of wrongdoing, the next most important thing that you can determine is whether or not the matter is timely. What's the statute of limitations? Because if they tell you their story of woe and their time limit is gone, it doesn't make a difference what happened to them, what injuries occurred, who was killed, makes no difference whatsoever. You cannot change the statute of limitations. So it is critical for you to get a sense of whether or not their matter is timely. So let's delve right into the timeliness issue. And this is something that's very important. And for those of you who don't know, the general time frame to file a lawsuit for medical malpractice in New York against a private doctor or private hospital is 2.5 years from the date of any wrongdoing. And of course, in all aspects of law, there are always exceptions to the general rule. Okay, but we're starting with that general time frame of 2.5 years from the date of the wrongdoing against a private doctor or private physician. So now, let's jump into one of those exceptions. Let's say your client was injured at a municipal hospital in the greater New York metropolitan area, such as Jacoby Hospital, Bellevue Hospital, Elmhurst Hospital, Queens General Hospital, Kings County Hospital, Metropolitan Hospital, and there are many others, just right here in the greater New York metropolitan area. If your client was injured in one of those municipal hospitals, you have to file a notice of claim within 90 days from the date of the wrongdoing. That is a prerequisite, it is a requirement. And that notice of claim must be served on the legal corporation that owns, operates, and maintains those municipal hospitals. And if you think you can file your notice of claim with the City of New York, you are 100% wrong. And if you did file it on the City of New York, you can basically call up your malpractice carrier now, okay? Because your claim will be dismissed, you won't have a lawsuit, and you're gonna be in big problems. You're gonna have problems. The entity that is responsible for these municipal hospitals is known as New York City Health and Hospitals Corporation, or the abbreviation HHC. That is the organization that's responsible for those municipal hospitals. And the time limit is extremely short, 90 days. And then you have only a year and 90 days within which to file a lawsuit from the date of the wrongdoing. Now, there are a number of procedural steps that occur after you file your notice of claim before you are permitted to file a lawsuit. And one of those steps involves a mini hearing that's known as a 50H hearing based upon the general obligations law. And it's like a mini deposition. And the purpose, its function, is so that the Health and Hospitals Corporation can investigate and determine what actually happened. Now, let me share this with you. Your notice of claim, in some regards, has to be as specific as possible. You have to identify what it is, first of all, where it occurred, where the problem occurred. You have to identify what you believe was done wrong, what injuries your client suffered as a result of that, and in some instances, you may be required to list or itemize the damages. And if you fail to put that information in there, you may get kicked out later on because your claim was not sufficient enough. It was not detailed enough. But let's assume that you've done that. You would then have only 1 year and 90 days to file suit. Now, what happens if your client comes to you, let's say 120 days, 180 days, 5 months, 6 months down the road after they suffered their injury? Can you still file a claim against Health and Hospitals Corporation? How many of you think they can? How many of you think they can't? Okay? The answer is there is a special procedure that we are allowed to go after to petition the court for the purposes of filing a late notice of claim. And in order to do that, there are procedural hurdles that we must overcome. So merely because the client comes to you and it's beyond those initial 90 days does not mean they can't bring a claim or a lawsuit. It simply means you as the attorney, or the attorney you're going to ultimately refer the case to, now has a significant hurdle and a significant challenge. And I'll give you an idea of what's involved. In order to bring a malpractice case in New York, we are not permitted by law to start a lawsuit unless we get confirmation by a medical expert that we have liability, that we have causation, and that we have damages. And that is an absolute rule. Okay? It's not like a car accident case or a trip and fall or a dog bite case where somebody comes to you and they say, "Mr. Oginski, I was just involved in a car accident. I got hit in the rear. Great. Tomorrow, we're going to start your lawsuit." Can't happen like that in malpractice. In malpractice, we have to investigate. We have to get all the medical records. I have to go through every single page of every record. And then I have to get confirmation, send all those records out to a medical expert in order to confirm that there's a valid basis for a case. And then I have to certify to the court that I have done that step. Otherwise, we are not permitted to bring a lawsuit for MedMal here in the state of New York. So that's a key component. So now, if your client is at the municipal hospital, suffered injury, it's beyond the 90 days, now you have to go through the same exact process, and the time is ticking. It takes months to get all these records. It takes weeks and months to get an expert to review all these records. So again, your time is ticking. You're losing precious time. And you have to do this as expeditiously as possible. So what happens next? There are instances where the court will permit the client to file a late notice of claim, provided the medical records are still available and there's a good likelihood that the doctors who are involved in the care are still there. Okay? There are instances where the court will say no. You no longer have the ability to bring a notice of claim, a late notice of claim, and now you are prevented from going forward with the case. All right. So now let's jump ahead to something else. We talked about the statute, the time limit for a municipal hospital. What about in a wrongful death case? How many of you believe that in a wrongful death case against a private doctor or private hospital, you have more time than in a regular malpractice case? Show of hands. How many think you have less time? Okay? The answer is you have less time. You have only 2 years from the date of death within which to bring a lawsuit for wrongful death in New York against a private doctor and private hospital. So now let me make things even worse and throw another monkey wrench in. Your client is in municipal hospital. They went to Bellevue Hospital for surgery. They died. The loved one died as a result of wrongdoing. And they come to you now. It's 2.5 years later. Can they bring a lawsuit? The answer is no. It's beyond the time limit for a municipal hospital. It's beyond the 1 year and 90 days. You do not get that benefit of 2 years in a municipal facility. So keep that in mind, because that will help you understand whether or not this particular matter may be timely. And remember, this is all done just as a filtering process, so that you don't have to spend hours and hours trying to identify the other issues you need to look at in a medical malpractice case. So now, if there's a wrongful death matter happen in a municipal hospital, you do not get the 2-year benefit. Your maximum is still only a year and 90 days. Let's talk about cases involving babies. In cases involving improper delivery that occurs at birth, anybody here know how much time you have in New York to file suit for a brain damaged baby? In New York, you have 10 years from the date of birth within which to file a lawsuit against a private doctor and private hospital. Now, what happens again if this incident happened in a municipal hospital? Do you get the benefit? Well, the short answer is no. You still have that limited time requirement. But again, as always, there are exceptions. And I'm not going to delve into the detailed exceptions here. I also want to bring up two other types of cases that may arise that you may learn about during your discussions with your potential clients. Cases involved against the state of New York, as well as cases against the Veterans Administration. Those are two separate entities that have their own quirky requirements, both of which require claims to be filed, and then a period of time later require you to file a lawsuit, but you have to give them a period of time in which to investigate. So again, I just raised that to give you an idea that those are separate and have their own complex time frames, and I'm not going to really go into that here right now. Now, let me throw in a couple of other wrenches, because this happens all the time. Anybody here familiar with the term foreign objects? I'm not talking about aliens. I'm talking about things that are left inside your body during the course of a procedure or during the course of surgery, things that should not be left there. How much time, anybody here know how much time you have in which to file a lawsuit for medical malpractice when there is a foreign object left inside your body? Shout it out if you know. Anybody? Okay. In order to evaluate how much time you have to answer two questions. The first question is, was this object that was left inside of you something that was intended to remain inside of you? This is a very important question for the purposes of determining whether or not you are timely in a foreign object case. If the matter was not intended to be left inside of you, then the injured victim has 1 year from the date of discovering that object within which to bring a lawsuit. And I should add one word to that. They have 1 year from reasonably discovering that object, or when they should have reasonably discovered that object, within which to bring a lawsuit. So let me put that in context. Let's say you have a hernia repair, and during the course of closing up the procedure, the doctor is sewing you up, and the tip of the needle breaks off. It can happen. And the doctor, while he's doing it, it just breaks off, and he's searching for it in the area where you're doing the surgery, and for whatever reason, he can't find that tip of the needle. He's looking, he's spending time, he gets a magnet, they can't find it, they can't identify it, and finally the doctor says, you know what, nothing's going to happen to this patient, I'm not even going to bother to tell her about it, it's going to be fine. Okay, what do you think happens? It's the foreshadowing, you know what's going to happen. 3 years later, the patient winds up having massive back pain, goes to her doctor, who sends her for x-rays, and the doctor tells her, Eureka, here's your problem, you've got a needle sticking in your back. She said, a needle? How do I have a needle in my back? I had surgery 3 years ago for a hernia. They get the operative report from the original surgery, and the doctor clearly put in there, tip of the needle broke off, made efforts to try and find it, couldn't find it, didn't think it would be a problem, have a nice day. So now she has to have surgery to get this needle removed. And now she comes to you and says, can I bring a lawsuit? Am I timely? Well, let's answer that original question. Was this needle tip something that was designed to be left inside of her body as part of the hernia repair surgery? The answer is no. Okay? It was designed to be used for the surgery, but not to be left inside. And as a result of that, she would then only have 1 year from the date of discovering that within which to bring a lawsuit. Now, let's change the facts around. Let's say a 40-year-old gentleman comes to you, newly married. He's trying to get pregnant, and neither he nor his wife, after trying for a year, have been successful. So they go for fertility testing. And during the course of fertility testing, it turns out his wife is perfectly fertile. He's the problem. What's the problem? Well, about 20 years earlier, in his young 20s, he developed a condition known as testicular torsion. That's a condition where the testicle twists upon itself, cutting off the spermatic cord, cutting off the nerves, and can kill the testicle because of a decreased blood flow. Well, they caught this one in time before he lost the testicle. But in order to prevent this from happening in the future, the doctor put a stitch into the cord leading from the testicle up to attach it to the scrotum so that this would not happen again. What this young man found out during the course of his fertility testing was that that stitch closed off that spermatic cord, which explains why he had no sperm coming up and explained why he was infertile. So now, in order to answer the question of whether his matter may be timely, let's go back and ask the question. Was this stitch that was put into the spermatic cord something that was designed to be left inside of his body? The answer is yes. In that instance where that stitch was designed to be left inside of his body, he would then have only 2.5 years from the date of the wrongdoing in which to bring a lawsuit, because that stitch was improperly placed. So because that happened more than 20 years ago, he no longer has the ability to bring a timely claim for his infertility. Now, it doesn't sound fair, it doesn't sound right, but that's the law as it exists today, and that's why these cases involving foreign objects are critical to understanding the key question, was this particular object designed to be left inside, or is it something that never, ever should have been there? And that will help you answer that key question right away of whether or not they have a problem. All right. Anybody find this stuff informational, helpful, educational?
Could you go over the key again about the object that's supposed to be left inside?
Sure. Sure, no problem. The key question, the question was, could I go over again the question that you need to answer in order to determine whether or not you're timely in a foreign object case. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. The question always will be, was the object that was left inside, was that something that was intended, the doctor intended to leave inside?
That's not the part I got that one.
Okay.
But what's the implication of that?
The implication is, if it's something that's not meant to be left inside, then you have only 1 year from the date of discovery in which to file suit.
And if it was meant to be inside?
If it was meant to be left inside, you have only 2.5 years from the date of the wrongdoing in which to bring suit. So it's dramatically different. Did that answer your question?
Yes.
Excellent.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Quick question?
Yes.
When you said on discovery, did I hear you say reasonable discovery earlier or just discovery?
Yes. The question again is it reasonable discovery or just discovery? There are cases where a patient should have recognized, or through the course of talking to their doctors, that something there should have been recognized. And that's where the reasonable discovery phrase comes in. So if you're talking to your doctor and they say, you know, I see something on the x-ray, and the patient says, okay, now I have to go to somebody else to get it evaluated. If the patient waits 2 years to get it evaluated or done, the patient knew 2 years earlier that there was something there and should have taken action. So that's what is meant by reasonable discovery. Okay? Now, let me throw in another monkey wrench into the time frame. And I'm spending a lot of time on this because it's so crucial. Remember, if the client comes to you and they're out of time, it doesn't matter what you do, what you know, or who you send them to, nothing is going to make a difference. So now, let me go through with you something known as continuous treatment. There is a doctrine in the law known as the continuous treatment rule. And before I share that rule with you, I want to give you this scenario. Let's go back to the mom that you've now gone to do the last will and testament for, the one who has the advanced metastatic breast cancer. And she tells you, when you talk to her, that a year and a half ago, let's make it out even further, 3 years ago, she told the doctor about that breast lump. And the doctor told her we'll follow it on a regular basis. And so now every 6 months, she comes back to the doctor's office for routine GYN checkup. The patient forgets about it. The doctor forgets about it. And over the course of the next 2.5, 3 years, they both forget about it until it comes back and resurges. Now, the question is, does that patient get the benefit of continuous treatment? Because what continuous treatment does is it will extend the time that you have or the client has in which to file a lawsuit against that particular physician. And in law, we call that tolling the statute of limitations. So let's answer that question. Does a patient who goes back to the doctor for routine follow-up, unrelated to the original complaint, get the benefit of what's known as continuous treatment? How many of you think they do? How many of you think they don't? The answer is they don't, and here's why. In order to get the benefit of continuous treatment, the patient has to go back to the doctor with the same complaint and same condition they originally went to them for. That is a requirement. So that although the patient strongly believes that they are getting continuous treatment because they continue to go back to their doctor, they have in their own mind, what are you talking about? I've been going to my doctor for years continuously. That's true, but not for the same condition, not for the same complaint about the breast lump that you originally made. And because of that, you don't get the benefit of extending the time limit in which to file your note to file a lawsuit. So when would this patient have had the opportunity to file? Within 2.5 years of the date of the wrongdoing. Okay? Yes, ma'am?
Well, what if the doctor writes in his notes that this is something that they have to watch? You know, he's put a note you know, review, but he just forgets.
Okay, so...
And, I mean, he's just going to him for, I mean, a breast exam is part of your general gynecological exam, so...
Sure.
And he said, we're going to follow this. And she doesn't have a complaint. I mean, she just doesn't feel any pain or feel it, so...
So the question is, if the doctor puts in their notes that they're going to follow this and observe it and act on it once the patient comes back for follow-up, what can you do? Will you get the benefit of continuous treatment? Well, let me answer that question because it's not a simple answer. You see, when you're talking to your client and they ask you whether or not there is continuous treatment, whether or not I can now bring a lawsuit at this late stage, it is impossible for you or actually anyone on that first consultation to give them an answer of whether or not there's continuous treatment. And let me tell you why. In order to give an educated answer about whether there's continuous treatment, I guarantee you that if you spoke to the client for an hour and got their version of what happened, they're going to tell you a story that's not going to be 100% historically accurate. Everybody forgets details, and that's understandable. But what is required is we have to get all of the medical records to evaluate every single page of every single record. And when I go through a record and look to see exactly what was done, here's what I look for. I need to know what complaints the patient made that was recorded. I need to know why the patient went to the doctor. I need to know what examination was done. Did the doctor address those complaints? Did they look at whatever it is the patient is complaining about? And now, here's where it gets interesting. Did the doctor formulate a treatment plan to address those particular complaints? Did they send the patient out for tests to be followed up? Did they do things affirmatively that says, I recognize you have this problem, I want you to do the following things, and I want you to return back at a certain time to check up on those? It is critical to understand why the patient went back on the next visit, why they went back on the follow-up visit, what complaints they made. Because if we don't know exactly why they went back and it turns out it was just for routine visits, the patient will no longer have the ability to use that continuous treatment rule in order to extend their time to file a lawsuit. So to answer your question, ma'am, you have to look and see in every single record why the patient was there, and importantly, what treatment plan the doctor created to address that problem. Now, here's something that's going to infuriate a lot of you and infuriates the plaintiff's bar constantly. What if the doctor did not formulate a treatment plan? The patient made a complaint, and the doctor says, don't worry, we'll watch it. Doesn't write anything in their note. And there's nothing to indicate the doctor has said, okay, here's our plan for this problem. Now, where the doctor fails to create a treatment plan, can you get the benefit when the patient goes back over and over again for other unrelated things, to say, look, but the doctor was supposed to recognize this, act on it, and he failed to do so. That's true. That is true. And in that instance, you'd have how much time to bring a lawsuit? 2.5 years from the date of that wrongdoing. But now let's say the 2.5 years have passed, and the doctor never formulated a treatment plan, never decided this is the action we're going to take for your particular matter. Do you get the benefit of extending that time period? The courts in this state say no, and that's a real travesty. And that's something that, you know, the courts are slowly recognizing as a real travesty. But that's a fact. Let me share this example with you. Let's say you have a dental problem. You go to the dentist, and the dentist works on a complaint you have about your upper molar on the left side. And after finishing that, he does a tooth in front, a tooth in back, a tooth on the bottom, tooth on the other side. And 3 years later, you wind up having another complication with that original tooth you went to him for. And the dentist who now treats you, a different doctor, says, I can't believe what you had done on the first visit, you know, 3 years ago. The guy was a total schmuck. He didn't know what he was doing. Now you're going to need the tooth extracted. Now you're going to need an implant. Now you're going to need all this treatment, all because of the following things. Is there continuous treatment? From the patient's point of view, what do they know? They know they've been going to this dentist who's been working in their mouth for the last 2.5, 3 years, right? So they think, yes, there is continuous treatment. I'm going to this dentist. I'm going to this doctor. And that's their thinking. And they have a right to think that way. It's natural. But from an attorney's standpoint, from a legal position, we have to look at those records and see which tooth was it the dentist treated. Was it tooth 15? Great. Now the dentist next worked on tooth 16, and then 14, and then 22. Well, if the doctor did not treat the same condition or same complaint that the patient originally went to them for, that patient does not get the benefit of continuous treatment and extending that time to file suit. So they would be out of luck. And again, that's the state of the law as it exists today. And that's why it turns out to be a travesty for many people who have this type of scenario. All right, I'm going to talk now about something called judgment calls. Many defense attorneys love to argue that the issues that arise in malpractice cases are judgment calls and do not rise to the level of what we call departures from good and accepted care. And let me give you an example of how that comes up. Let's say you have a medical problem and you now go to five different doctors to evaluate that medical problem. Four of them tell you, let's treat it this way. The fifth doctor says, no, we're going to treat it this way. And you like the fifth doctor better. It's less invasive. There are less problems associated with what he's recommending. And you opt to have that done, a procedure done, with doctor number five. Lo and behold, you wind up getting a significant complication with doctor number five. And you turn around and say, doctor, what you recommended was a departure from good and accepted practice. Well, merely because of the fact that the doctor's choice to use one procedure over another, does that in and of itself give rise to malpractice? How many of you think yes? How many think no? You are right, the ones who said no. And here's why. As long as the treatment that's being offered is within medical accepted standards, even though it's not in the majority, even though most doctors would not do that type of procedure, as long as it's still medically acceptable, if the patient has the procedure and goes forward, has a complication, the mere fact that the doctor chose to use one procedure over another does not necessarily give rise to evidence of malpractice. And that's a concept that a lot of injured patients don't recognize. And they say, but all these other doctors said I should not have had that done. They wouldn't, and the phrase that I hear often is, they told me they wouldn't do it. Well, that's what prompts the call to the office. And when I explain to them that that does not equate to malpractice, they get very upset and they get very angry. What do you mean? My doctor told me that he never should have done it. Well, he never would have done it, but if the medical community still recognizes it as something that is an option and is an acceptable option, then you're going to have a very tough time getting a medical expert in to prove that there is wrongdoing, that there's a departure from good and accepted care. Let me share with you a case I handled that I call a urology nightmare. And it truly was. And you'll understand why in just a moment. 37-year-old man was having difficulty urinating, and he went to his urologist. And as part of the procedure to open up the urethra, that's the tube that leads urine out through the penis, he did a procedure known as a cold knife urethrotomy. And that sounds as painful as the term is, okay? And you know, but that's something that had to be done. So they actually go in and remove with a knife this scar tissue that had built up in this tube leading the urine out. But that's a short-term solution. And a couple of months later, this problem arose again. He had difficulty urinating. So the doctor again did the same procedure. And again, it's a short-term solution. So now, problem came back. And the doctor says, you know what? I have a great idea. We're going to put in a device known as a stent, a wire mesh stent into your urethra, into that tube. And here's what it's designed to do. It's a coil. It's a mesh coil that's spring-loaded. And once we insert it into that tube, it will open up with the purpose of keeping that tube open. And it'll allow the urine to pass through freely. Now, the patient was reassured by the doctor, told that this was a wonderful procedure, this is something that could happen, and it's something that's going to benefit him. And that's exactly what the patient agreed to. So during the course of the procedure, the doctor put in this spring-loaded implant into the urethra and realized, you know what, he needs another one right behind it, so I'm going to put in two of them. That was, in our opinion, clear departures from good and accepted medical practice. And I'll tell you why in just a moment. What this patient was never told was that these devices were meant to be put in to elderly gentlemen, people who would no longer be able to have erections. Because every time a young man would have an erection, it would cause unbearable, excruciating, agonizing, unending pain. Absolutely horrendous. And when you put in these stents, what they are designed to do is to go in and become literally embedded within the tube so that the skin cells now become and hold this in place. It's supposed to be permanent. They call that epithelialization, so that the stent doesn't move and the opening stays open. So what was the problem here? Well, this young man was not elderly. He was 37, had a family, had a wife. And every time he had an erection, he had such unbelievable, excruciating pain, he wanted to kill himself. Honest to God, never had a problem before, never had a psychiatric problem. The doctor's notes, and this was remarkable, indicates patient is in such pain, he states he wants to kill himself. And this happened over and over again. It was unbearable. So finally, the doctor said to him, you know what? After 2 months, said, I want to take you back into the hospital. And under anesthesia, I'm going to try and move those stents. Let's see if we can get you some relief. This was mistake number two. Okay, because remember, I told you those things are designed to become permanent and implanted in the urethra. So now, under anesthesia, the doctor goes and tries to remove or move it in the position. And as he tries to do that, guess what? It doesn't move because it's now embedded within the skin. So he starts to pull out strand by strand of each of these metal wire meshes that start ripping off. And as you can imagine from what I'm describing to you, again, as painful as I'm telling you now, this was horrendous. He destroyed this entire man's urethra as he's pulling out each of these pieces of metal so that it looked like an explosion had gone off inside the tube that takes urine out. Needless to say, this man needed to have massive reconstructive urological surgery where they had to revise his entire urethra. And you have to ask yourself, what happens to the urine during the time that this surgery is happening and he's healing? They had to create something known as a urinary diversion. Urine has to come out somewhere. And where did it come out? They had to make a hole between his anus and his scrotum. So every time he needed to urinate, he had to sit down like a woman, go to the bathroom, and this went on for 18 months until his urethra was healed up. So when I tell you that this was a urology nightmare, I'm truly telling you this was devastating. And we were able to settle this very successfully at mediation. But the amazing thing, the amazing thing was, now listen to this. The defense argued throughout the entire mediation, throughout the entire litigation, this was a judgment call on behalf of the doctor, that using these stents was an acceptable procedure. And you know what? We said you're absolutely right. It is an acceptable procedure if you're over the age of 65 and you no longer have the ability to maintain an erection. Then you're okay. But on top of that, you've not only used something in a man that should never have had it, but you put it in the wrong place, too far down, so that now when he had the erection, it was excruciating and unbearable. So the judgment call raised as a defense, where you have a doctor who says, no, it's acceptable. As long as you have medical experts to come in and testify that that particular procedure, using that technique, was a departure from good and accepted care, you're going to be on good ground when you make out your case, and now you present your case to the jury. I want you to think about something else that should be very important for each of your practices. How do you identify and how do you get your message out to your ideal clients, people who need you and want to use your services? One of the key things that you have to keep in mind is creating messages that people want and need to know. You know, one of the best things that I have found with attorneys who do not practice med-mal law in New York is when they talk to these people on an everyday basis and they learn that there might be something going on, one of the best things that you can do as a resource, as a go-to resource, is after talking to them and determining that they may have a viable case, you can turn to them and say, you know what? I have a book for you, a book that was written by an experienced trial attorney who will explain to you how these cases work. And by doing that, you're doing them a service. You're helping them understand how the lawsuit process works. And so I just want to briefly tell you about, and I know Tina mentioned some of my books, and I have two of them here, I'll pass them around. One of them is called Secrets of a New York Medical Malpractice Attorney, and it explains how the lawsuit process works in New York. Another book that I have here today is called Beyond the Emergency Room Doors. The next title you'll like, it's called Doctors Gone Wild. And the last book involves wrongful death, and it's titled after the phrase, you know, in case of emergency, break glass. Well, this one is titled In Case of Death, Here's What You Need to Know. Okay. So the reason I bring this up is because I wrote these four consumer-oriented books to help consumers, my ideal clients, understand how these cases work. And when I talk to attorneys who don't do med-mal law, I give them an opportunity. I said, listen, if you want to look great to your clients after you talk to them, pull out a copy of my book that I've given to you and say, here's a great book for you to read. Learn about it. It answers a lot of questions. It'll help you understand how things work. Read them yourself. Give them to your clients. It's a great way for you to say, here's somebody who does this on a regular basis. Take a look at these books. It'll help you understand how the process works. And the great thing I found with these is that very few attorneys in New York do this. And there's no reason that you shouldn't be doing it. And I want you to think about how you can model that technique in your own practice. So whether you handle securities or bankruptcy or real estate, why can't you put together a booklet or a pamphlet to people who refer cases to you? So now when they get a potential client, they have that in their office to hand to their client and say, hey, I want you to go speak to this attorney. You're going to learn a lot from this. Okay? All right. So now that you've had a chance to recuperate from that horrible, horrible story, let me share with you another horrible story. A gentleman is walking down a parade here in Brooklyn, and he and his friend are horsing around. While they're horsing around, one of the guys, well-built, winds up dislocating his shoulder. And during the course of the dislocation, he realizes he can't pop his shoulder back in. So he goes to his local hospital, and when he goes to the hospital, the doctors come down to the emergency room, and they make every effort to try and put the shoulder back in. For any of you who've been in a situation where you've had a dislocated joint, you're going to know that it is massively painful. And so they doped him up with some narcotic painkillers, and they had to bring in five people to try and manipulate putting his arm back into its socket. And they were not successful. So they called in even more people. And there are a lot of muscles, especially in a bodybuilder. A lot of muscles built up, it gets very tight. And so in order to put the joint back together again, you literally have to do unusual machinations to pull it out, apply traction, twist it, put it back in, and pop it into the socket. And this went on. And finally, they were able to successfully do it. It took a while, but now after the procedure, his arm swelled up like a balloon. And they said, you know what, let's hold you overnight. Let's observe you just to make sure everything's fine. And that's what they did. It was a good choice to do it. But during the night, they had on the B team. And unfortunately for this man, the B team didn't recognize that he was having neurological symptoms in his hand. The blood flow to his fingers was diminished. He was getting tingling. He was having difficulty moving. And he told the nurses. And the nurses blew it off. Said, don't worry, you'll be fine. It wasn't until the morning when the next shift came in and recognized that this is a real red flag. It's a real problem. And the problem is that it's an indication that there's a lack of blood flow. So what did they do? At that point, they went ahead and got a CAT scan. The problem at that point was that the CAT scan was being read by one of the doctors on the B team from the overnight shift. And he didn't recognize what was there that should have been seen. So now, a little bit later on in the morning, the senior attendings come in. They're reviewing all the stuff done by the junior team from the night before. And they come to the realization that there's some problem here. There is pressure building up against the nerve that controls what's called the brachial plexus. And as a result, this man now is having problems with his hand. What do? They make a decision. They have to get this guy into surgery immediately. They have to decompress all the fluid that's building up under his armpit from here all the way down to his chest. And when they do that, there's a lot of fluid that was built up causing pressure. Unfortunately for this man, that pressure was so significant that it cut off the blood supply to the nerve, and they were never able to get it back. So here's a guy who is horsing around, has an injury to his shoulder. Because of the excessive manipulation they did, and they didn't recognize that this nerve pressure was building up, this gentleman lost permanent nerve function to his arm. And as a result, his arm literally, he was a bodybuilder, literally withered to a small fraction of its original size because there was no longer blood supply to the nerves controlling that arm. This man underwent multiple surgeries to try and fix this, to help him, and unfortunately, his bodybuilding career was over, all because the B team was on and didn't recognize this. So I bring this up because I want to ask you this question. The mere fact that a complication occurs during the course of a procedure, is that evidence of malpractice? Yes? Who says yes? Who says no? You are correct. The answer is no. The mere fact that a bad outcome occurs as a result of treatment does not in and of itself mean that there's wrongdoing. But at what point does that rise to the level that you have wrongdoing, that you have a departure from good care? When I started, remember I told you about the different categories of cases that can occur? Well, how about this scenario? You have the hernia surgery, you have some type of abdominal surgery, and during the course of the surgery, the surgeon inadvertently makes a hole in the bowel. That is known as an acceptable medical risk. It shouldn't happen, but it can happen because it's an adjacent organ. And remind me to tell you about the informed consent cases. So when you have an injury to an adjacent organ, again, people, the mindset of these injured victims are, listen, I walked in healthy to the hospital. I came out in a wheelchair. I came out paralyzed. Something must have been done wrong. Well, the reality is, it may have, then again, it may not have. But when you have an injury to an adjacent organ that occurs during surgery, the doctors and the experts say that can happen. So how can that rise to the level of malpractice? It can rise to the level where the doctor and the surgical team fail to recognize that there is that injury that occurred during surgery. So if they actually recognize that the injury occurred at the time it was made, they now have the ability to correct it during the course of surgery before you wake up. And that's acceptable. If, however, they close you up, they don't recognize it, your condition gets worse, ultimately you suffer significant injury or die, that's where these things rise to the level of malpractice. The failure to timely recognize, diagnose, and treat intraoperatively a particular problem, that's where the wrongdoing occurs. And it also happens after the patient is sent home. So now the patient calls the doctor and says, "Doctor, I'm telling you, I'm having these abdominal pains." And the doctor says, "Don't worry, it's normal post-operative pain." And you're saying, "No, I'm telling you, I just don't feel right." Doctor says, "Don't worry, come back for your regularly scheduled visit." Well, they never make it to the visit. Why? Because they drop dead from a massive infection known as sepsis. And that rises to the level of malpractice. So now, let's talk about lack of informed consent. When your client tells you, "The doctor never told me I could suffer this complication," do you think they have a valid basis for a case? The answer is maybe. And I have to share this with you also. If you take on a case where that is the only claim being alleged, that the doctor didn't tell me I could suffer the following problems, I am going to strongly suggest to you to run very fast away from that type of case. And there's a specific reason for that. You never, ever want to rest on the fact that you have a case with the only claim of being what's called lack of informed consent. What does that mean? It means the patient claims that the doctor failed to give them sufficient information so they can make an educated decision about whether this procedure was right for them. And if the patient didn't have that knowledge and information, then how could they possibly make an educated decision about whether this was the right choice for them? So here's what typically happens. The patient says, "The doctor never told me I could have this complication." The doctor turns around and says, "Of course I told them." So now you have a classic he said, she said situation. And if that's all you're resting your hat on a medical malpractice case, I will tell you right now, you will lose 100 out of 100 times. Why? Because juries in the state of New York like doctors. They do. And here's a couple of statistics that you may not know about. The statistics are that 95% of all valid cases in New York ultimately settle prior to trial. of the remaining 5% that go to trial, 2/3 of them are won by the doctors and hospitals. So the injured victim is at a significant disadvantage when bringing a case to trial. Not that they can't win, but that it's a very challenging effort. Okay, so now we're talking about the scenario about lack of informed consent. So why don't you just bring a case against the doctor for lack of informed consent? Because now a jury has to decide who they like better. Do they believe the doctor who says, I did go ahead and tell the patient about these risks, benefits and alternatives, and the patient says, no, he didn't. Now, here's something else interesting. Imagine this. With every procedure, with every medication, there are always risks associated with everything a doctor does. One of the most obvious, the biggest risk ever, is you can die. You can die from anesthesia. You can die from the procedure. Okay? What do you think would happen if the doctors told all of us that every time you're going to have a procedure, there's a likelihood you're going to die? How many of you think that patients would ever have surgery, have a procedure done? Most of us wouldn't, because they wouldn't take that obvious risk, even though it's a very minor risk, but it's the most significant one. So what always winds up happening is I get the call that says, Mr. Oginski, I want you to evaluate my case. I think the doctor didn't tell me about the risks. And I say, really? Did they tell you about any risks? Well, yes. They told me I could get infection, I could get bleeding, I can get injury to another organ. Okay. And what injury did you suffer? Well, I had cataract surgery and now I'm blind. Okay. Now, in case you don't know, that is a risk and a complication that can occur from well-performed surgery. So I tell the patient, I said, listen, are you telling me the doctor didn't describe to you the possibility that you could go blind following this procedure? Yes. I said, did you read the form that they gave to you? Well, I had my husband read it. Did he read it? No, he just signed it. They said, sign here. Okay. So the bottom line is, these doctors, for the most part, tell the patients about the most significant or most likely risks. They don't go into the detail about every possible risk. Otherwise, they'd be there for hours, and nobody would ever have procedures. Yes, ma'am?
It's true that it's at their discretion sometimes not to disclose the risks, so they feel it's not, it's reasonably will affect you in a wrong way.
Yes.
I'm not articulating exactly, but that's the problem, and that's really screwed up.
Yes, she raises the point and says, listen, it's within the doctor's discretion whether or not to tell the patient about all the risks. And you are right in the sense that they have to exercise their judgment, their best medical judgment, to determine what risks you need to know about. And that becomes a fight. But I address this because now you're deciding whether or not they may have a valid case. And now all you hear from them is just, the doctor didn't tell me. But if you don't have a medical expert who confirms that there is also wrongdoing that occurred as a result of this and they suffered a physical injury, you're not going anywhere. Now, let me also tell you this. In a malpractice case, when you bring a claim for lack of informed consent, we are required to bring in a medical expert to support that particular claim. Now, imagine this scenario. The doctor's on the witness stand, our expert. Dr. Gold, I want you to assume that Mrs. Jones has testified that the doctor never told her husband about the following risks, and she was in the office at the time. Based upon that fact that he didn't tell her about the risks, benefits, or alternatives, would you agree that's a departure from good and accepted care? Yes, I would. Wonderful. And would you agree that they no longer had the ability to make an educated decision about whether this procedure was right for them? Yes, I would. Thank you, doctor. Now the defense attorney gets up. Dr. Gold, I'd like to ask you this question. I want you to assume that Dr. Gonzalez has testified in this trial that he did tell the patient about all the risks, benefits, and alternatives. Assuming that to be true, would you agree that the doctor did everything appropriate in educating the patient about their options and benefits and risks? Yes, I would. Thank you, Dr. Gold. Have a nice day. So now what are we left with? We're left with a jury who still has to make a decision about who they believe. Do they believe the patient? Do they believe the doctor? And it's never a good position to have only that claim and to rest only on that. Which now brings me to psychological injuries. If you learn from talking to your client that this person went to a doctor, they were verbally abused, they suffered all sorts of emotional, mental trauma, but have no physical injuries, I am going to make another strong suggestion to you. Run as fast as you can away from that possible case, in a polite way. And the reason I say that is because those types of cases come with a tremendous amount of baggage. Those patients typically have histories of psychiatric and psychological and emotional problems. And now, as an attorney who's trying to identify whether or not the injuries occurred from the doctor's wrongdoing, it's going to be extremely difficult, if not challenging, to show that they are separate and distinct from the problems the patient had in the past. And again, this is not to say that they don't have a valid basis for a case, they may, but if all they have are psychological and emotional injuries, my recommendation after doing this now for more than 24 and a half years is to stay far away from it. And there are some attorneys, some really smart attorneys who will take on those cases, and I'll just tell you quickly about what types of those cases are, where you have a patient who's in a psych facility who is suicidal. And now they release the patient, they think the patient is fine, patient goes home, and 2 days later kills himself. There may have been warning signs, indications that the doctors at the hospital missed, misrecognized, and now as a result, the patient kills himself, and that type of case may be viable. But for the most part, the psychiatric injury cases, stay away from, focus on the ones with injuries together with the psychiatric and emotional injuries as well. Always look to see what physical injuries have occurred. Does anybody know what type of case you do not need to bring in a medical expert to testify in a malpractice case? Anybody? It involves a three-word Latin phrase, and you all know what that phrase is. I'm going to tell you in a second. Anybody? What did I hear? Res ipsa loquitur. Okay? The thing speaks for itself. Right? We all know it from documents, but from an evidence standpoint, remember, in a malpractice case, we are required to bring in a medical expert to support every one of the elements of our claim. If we don't have a medical expert, we can't get our foot in the door. We'll get dismissed on summary judgment after we make our opening remarks. So we need a medical expert, but there's only one type of scenario where we don't. And that's in the case, and I'll give you a great example. A gentleman goes in for hand surgery on his left hand. He comes out of surgery with a big bandage over his right shoulder, and he's told that he suffered a third-degree burn on his right shoulder. How is that possible? Patient goes in for surgery on his left hand, comes out with the surgery being done, but he also has a third-degree burn to his shoulder. How is that possible? Well, the answer is, it shouldn't happen. The patient was under the sole and exclusive care of the doctors in the hospital. He was under anesthesia at the time. So how is it physically possible that he might have contributed or caused his own injury? Where it becomes obvious and apparent, and you don't need a medical expert to tell a layperson that, hey, if you're going in to have surgery on your left hand, you should not come out of surgery with a burn injury to your opposite shoulder. It's as obvious, right? Well, the law in New York says, in that instance, you don't need a medical expert. You can rely on the legal doctrine known as res ipsa loquitur. But I will tell you, the better practice, even though you don't need a doctor to do that, you still want to have one to come in and testify to support your claim, and here's why. It all goes back to the defense argument. And you know the book title that I have, Doctors Gone Wild? Well, one of the outrageous claims that have come up in the past is in this exact scenario. In order for the client, for the patient, to get the benefit of not needing to bring in an expert, we have to show that the doctors and the hospital staff were in exclusive control of what happened. And this typically will happen when a patient is under anesthesia during surgery. But I have seen this defense being raised. Here's what happened, and here's why we're not responsible, the doctor argues. During the course of the procedure, although the patient was under anesthesia, they suffered an uncontrollable twitch. And as a result of that, that twitch caused the patient's hand to fly up, hit the doctor who was holding a cautery device, a burning device, to close off bleeding vessels, that caused the drape to catch fire, that caused the third-degree burn to the patient's shoulder. And therefore, you can't hold us accountable for that happening. Why? Because the patient was in control, even though they had some anesthesia, and now you still need an expert to come in and say how that's physically impossible and that never should have happened. So even though you can use that doctrine to not have to bring in a medical expert, The better practice is always to bring in the expert and not have to rely on the possibility that the defense is going to raise one of their doctor's gone wild defenses to now show that, hey, this patient should not have done what they did and contributed to their own injury. And if it turns out a jury believes them, we're going to lose on that claim. So that's why you always will need to have an expert come in to testify about departures from good care, that the departures were a substantial factor in causing and bringing about injury, and that the injuries are significant and permanent. Now, you may find from talking to your client that the injuries that they have are not that significant. They may have bruising. They may have something that occurred because of something done wrong, but it's just not that significant. Is that the type of case that you want to handle or send out to an experienced attorney? The answer most likely is no. The injuries need to be significant enough to justify making a substantial investment in prosecuting the case. So if you only have bruising, my suggestion is it's not going to be the right type of case for an experienced med mal attorney. If you have fractures, need another surgery, if you have something more substantial, that may be the right type of case to pursue and investigate. Now, what do you do in the instance where you've now identified that there's something going on here? You've now made a determination that in all likelihood, this case is timely. You've now filtered in your own mind that certain time frames apply and that this case probably is timely and that there is continuous treatment or something along those lines. What do you do next? Well, what you do next is you have to determine who are the possible defendants. Who are the people involved here who committed the wrongdoings? Is it a resident who works in a hospital? Is it a private attending? Is it hospital staff? Is it nurses, technicians? Who are they? And I bring this up because it's important to understand vicarious liability. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with it, vicarious liability simply means that the employer is responsible for the acts of the employee. So if you are working in a hospital, if you are working for a medical group, you must always include the medical entity, the hospital, the medical group as part of your lawsuit. So just keep that in the back of your mind as you try and understand whether or not who are the possible defendants. What do you do when now you are trying to decide, and this is something that I ask all referring attorneys. I say, what is the racial profile of this particular individual? And for those of you who are politically correct, I will tell you right now that there are many people who will not talk about racial profiling as it applies to injured victims. And I'm going to tell you right now that if you ignore the racial profiling aspect, you are doing yourself and your potential client a huge disservice. Because no matter how politically correct we are, this is taught in every CLE trial practice scenario, you always have to take that into account. So I want to know what nationality the injured victim is. I want to know what their race is. Why? Because every county in the state of New York has their own jury profile. There's a big difference between going into Bronx County compared to Rockland County, compared to Westchester, compared to Manhattan, compared to Queens and Nassau. Every single county is different. And so although it may not make an overall strategic decision, or it may not be the factor that decides whether or not to take on the case, it's still an important one and something you need to just think about. Not verbalized to anybody except the referring attorney, but it's something that you will be asked. Next thing you need to think about is, what type of witness will this particular injured victim make if they go to trial? Are they verbal? Can they communicate? Do they understand? What type of person will this make when they get up on the witness stand to be asked questions? Are they going to be likable? Likability is a huge, huge component of whether or not you may have a valid case. And if there's a question, the victim's likability can sometimes sway the jury solely on the fact that they're nice, they're kind, they're wonderful and sweet and warm and fuzzy. So again, you have to think about that. Which brings me to the next question. You've now gone through this entire process. You've asked them the key question, what do you think was done wrong and what injury did you suffer as a result of that? You've determined in your own minds that this matter may be timely. You now have an idea of who this person is, what kind of witness they're going to be, and now you have an idea of what type of case this involves. And the question you now have to ask yourself is, what do you do next? You've got all this great information. What do you do next? The answer is, now's the time for you to decide whether to refer the case out to an experienced trial attorney, or do you try and handle this on your own? And there are some attorneys who will try and handle this on their own. And again, I'll make another suggestion to you, that if you do not handle these types of cases on a daily basis, my strong recommendation is to send it out to experienced trial counsel. And the reason is, there are many, many procedural pitfalls that you are going to encounter, and you will get stuck in the mud, and it may prove impossible for you to get out of if you don't do this on a regular basis. So the better practice is to make a decision and say to the client, listen, I have an excellent attorney I want you to speak to who may be able to help. They're going to investigate and evaluate whether or not you have a case. And you can give them your thoughts about what you think based upon the knowledge that you gleaned this morning of whether or not they may have a basis and how you might be able to help them. Because now what have you done? What you've done is now you've provided them a resource, and you are now looked as the go-to resource person to help solve their other legal problems. That's why you look great, because here you are trying to help solve their legal problem that's unrelated to your area and practice of law. Okay, does that make sense? All right, so here's something that you really need to know about when you make that decision to send the case out to an attorney. In New York, the attorney's fees in a medical malpractice case are dramatically different than in a negligence case. So for those of you who don't know, in a car accident case, in a dog bite case, a trip and fall, those cases, the attorney's fee after the expenses are repaid to the law firm is one-third. One-third. So typically, if you refer a personal injury case to a PI attorney, they will give you one-third after their expenses of their own attorney's fee. In a malpractice case, the fees are dramatically different. Malpractice cases only start, and they have what's called a sliding scale. So the fees after expenses are reimbursed, it starts at 30% and drops by 5% as we get more and more money. So to give you an example, if we get anywhere from $1 to $250,000, the fee for that segment is only 30%. If we get anywhere from $250,000 to $500,000, the fee then drops to 25%. If we get anywhere from $500,000 to $1 million, the fee for that is 20%. And it continues to drop until we reach a ceiling of $1.25 million. Anything above that, the lawyer's fee is only 10%. So let me give you an example. 2 weeks ago, I settled a case involving a wrongful death, involving a hernia repair, where a hole was made in the bowel. And it was unrecognized. The patient ultimately died because they failed to recognize, what's the word? Sepsis, causing a massive infection, causing a death that was not recognized until the autopsy was done. And just in this scenario, what happened was the doctors recognized the hole in the bowel during surgery, recognized it. The problem arose when the doctor now made a judgment call, and what he did was, in our opinion, a departure from good care. He was a GYN cancer surgeon. We argued that he should have called in a bowel surgeon or a colorectal surgeon or a general surgeon to come in and repair that bowel. Instead, his team opted to do it on their own. And when you have an injury involving a bowel, if it's a significant one, you have to remove and cut out the damaged portion of the bowel. But then you're left with two ends that are open. You have to connect the two together and then sew it up tight to form a watertight seal. That's known as an end-to-end anastomosis. Well, we argued in this scenario that the doctor and his team didn't do it right, because when the surgeon 3 days later, 2 days later, went back in to evaluate, once they opened the belly, what he found was astonishing. He found that the fecal contents from inside the intestines were in her abdominal cavity where it never should have been. And that's why she was getting sicker and sicker, and nobody recognized it. And more importantly, that bowel that was supposed to be closed together with a watertight seal was wide open. That's where everything was coming from. She died shortly after, a few hours later. And I settled that case 2 weeks ago during mediation for $840,000. Now, the attorney's fee on that particular case was 24.5%. So if you were to have sent that case to me as a referral, what happens then is you would get a percentage of the percentage that I recovered. So if I got 24.5%, you would get 24.5% of what I was able to recover. Okay? If I was able to recover 20%, you would then get 20% of what I was able to recover. So if you make that decision to send a case out to a referring attorney, you must get confirmation of that in writing. always, 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 as attorneys, you know that, but most of you do not do that, make sure that confirmation with your referring attorney is in writing. And the good attorneys will gladly do that. Now, the next thing you need to know is once you've made that decision to refer the case out, you are required to fill out a retainer statement and file it with the Office of Court Administration. It's known as an OCA retainer. And it basically says, I retained Mrs. Jones on this date, and I referred the case to Mr. Oginski. And this way, it will permit you to receive a referral fee at the end of the case if we are successful. Otherwise, if you fail to prepare a retainer statement, there is no way that you can ever justify getting a referral fee because you failed to follow the court rules. So now, here's a great system that I use and other experienced attorneys use as well. When I take on a case, the first thing I do, if it's referred by another attorney, is I go ahead and prepare the documents for our retainer, and I also do the same for you. So this way, the only thing you have to do is sign the papers I send to you. The Office of Court Administration sends us back your postcard with your code on it, and we put it in our file. So at the end, again, we have that information. We don't have to trouble you. The really good attorneys, I find, have a system in place to keep you and the client advised of what's going on in the case at all times. And here's what I mean. When an attorney refers a case to someone else, the biggest problem arises when they ask, after months, what's happening on this case I sent to you? I haven't heard from you. I don't hear from the client. What's happening? And you lose trust. You lose faith. So the really smart attorneys do the same thing that I do, where they turn around and they have a system in place where, and I should tell you this, I speak to my clients every single month, whether something is happening on their case or not. And I do that for two reasons. I want to know how they're doing, how they're coping, what problems they're having, and I want to give them status updates on their case, even if nothing is happening on their matter, because it gives them the reassurance that I'm still on top of their case and know what's going on. Otherwise, the client is left to wonder, I haven't heard from the lawyer in months and months. I have no idea what's happening. They get into arguments with their family, with their friends. That's something you don't want to do. But as the referring attorney, you are copied on all correspondence, and you are encouraged to call the client on a regular basis to find out and keep in touch with them. Because remember, they're still your client. They still came to you with a problem. So now you're still talking to them, but at the same time, you're helping them through this other problem. So ask the attorney you're sending them to, listen, do you have a system in place that keeps me in the loop, that keeps the client in the loop? That's a really useful point, something you should keep in mind. Yes, sir?
Is there a requirement that the referring attorney do some of the work?
Absolutely. The question is there a, now I was just going to address that. The question is there a requirement that the referring attorney do some level of legal work to justify a fee? The answer is yes. So let me share with you what is considered to be some level of legal work. And that phrase is very left ambiguous for a reason. In the past, a lawyer could simply call up another attorney and say, hey, listen, I'm sending over Mrs. Jones to you. Do me a favor, you handle her case. And if they were successful, the attorney, if they were upstanding, they would send the attorney the referral fee. However, things have changed. And what is required now is that in order for you to justify a referral fee, you must do some level of legal work. What does that mean? Does that mean that if you consult with a client and formulate in your own mind the different possible legal claims, that's some level of legal work? There are cases that have said yes. If you obtain the client's medical records, is that considered to be some level of legal work? Many people would say yes. If you communicate with the client and with the attorney that you send the client to about what's happening on their case and discuss strategies and tips, is that considered to be some level of legal work? The answer is yes. So you are absolutely right when you ask the question, what do I need to do in order to justify some level of legal work to enjoy a referral fee if you are successful? That is something that I'm glad you raised because it is always, always required. Now, does anybody check on it? The reality is nobody really checks on it until there is an objection. Who raises the objection? Either the attorney who you sent the case to experienced a tremendous result and doesn't want to give you the referral fee, or the client says, and this is really important, I never authorized you to give the original attorney a share of the fee. Now, when that happens, you've got a problem. Why is that? Because as part of your discussion with your potential client, You have to say to them, hey, Mrs. Jones, I'm going to send you to Mr. Oginski. He's an experienced attorney. And if we are successful, if he's successful with your case, because I'm sending you to him, he and I are going to be sharing one attorney's fee. Is that okay with you? And the clients will always say yes. But you have to tell them. And that should be in the retainer statement, indicating that the client consents and recognizes that you will be receiving a percentage of the fee if you're successful. And I, as the attorney who takes on the case, also have that obligation. So now, we talked about the opinions, we talked about venue, we talked about a lot of things. Oh, if the matter involves a wrongful death claim, here are some things I want you to think about that you're going to need to describe to the attorney when you refer the case out. What was the age of the victim? Was there an autopsy done? What was the cause of death? These are critical things. Who are the beneficiaries? Are they children or adults? It makes a huge difference. Were they married? Were they earning a living? Is there pecuniary loss? Is there financial loss to the family as a direct result of this death? If there isn't, that's going to minimize the claim, and you're probably only going after pain and suffering and loss of services or loss of a spouse, which can still be substantial, but when you have lost earnings claim as well, it's going to dramatically improve the value of the particular case. I'm going to end up with this scenario. You are obligated, when I say you, the attorney who takes on a case, is obligated to determine whether or not there is a lien against any proceeds in a lawsuit. And here's what I mean. Let's say your victim winds up having a valid case, there we go, has a valid case, and now their health insurance paid for all of their medical care. About a year and a half ago, the law changed. So what would happen in that instance is that now the private health insurance company would be able to come to you as the attorney and say, listen, we paid $100,000 for your client's medical bills. Pay us back before you ever dispense any money to your client. And we would then have to negotiate with that private health insurance company to do that, to make sure that lien was resolved. Well, the legislature finally got smart and turned around and said, you know what? We're not going to permit that to happen anymore. Instead, what we're going to do, and here's why, the reason we're not doing that is because you as the patient contractually conform the contractual obligation with the health insurance company. You paid a premium every single month. And for that benefit, the health insurance company had a contractual obligation to pay for your medical bills, regardless of how they were incurred. So now that you suffered injury and you incurred bills, Mr. Health Insurance Company, sorry, you had a contractual obligation to pay those bills and you cannot ask to be reimbursed from somebody else's lawsuit to get repaid. You had that contractual obligation. And that was a wonderful thing for injured victims. Except, what happens if the victim is getting Medicare or Medicaid? That doesn't apply. In fact, if your victim is elderly, you have to assume that they're getting Medicare. And if you fail to address Medicare, Medicare can come after you as the attorney for treble damages of the amount that they are claiming. It's horrendous. They don't have to go after the client. They can go after you. So you are obligated to send out a letter. I do that the moment the client walks in the door to Medicare saying, hey, we represent Mrs. Jones. Please tell us whether or not you're going to be claiming a lien in this case. And we can try and negotiate with them later on. Medicaid is the same thing. So Medicaid, you also have an affirmative obligation to deal with and resolve those liens before the client ever gets paid. And let me share with you this one last story involving a case that I took on that where Medicare destroyed my client's case. An adult man was walking across the street hit by a car. His sister calls me up. My brother's in the hospital. He suffered massive injuries, fractured femur. He needed surgery, trachea problems, breathing tube, feeding tube. He's in the hospital for 3.5 weeks. Within 2 weeks of getting that call, I was able to determine and settle the case for $100,000, the maximum insurance that the car had. But what I didn't know at that time was that this guy was a Medicare recipient and also a Medicaid recipient. And by the time he got out of the hospital, his bills were $350,000. So after my expenses and my fee, he was left with approximately $60,000. And I went to Medicare and Medicaid and I said, listen, you have to reduce the amount you're claiming. They said, no. I said, if you don't, he's going to wind up with nothing. They said, tough. We appealed it on humanitarian grounds. We appealed it on all sorts of other grounds. They turned around and said, no. So the ultimate result was that the client wound up getting literally only a few dollars, I felt like an idiot because I'd taken on a case where I served the client no real direct purpose. And I told the sister, I said, I feel horrible. I never, ever would take on a case had I known that Medicare and Medicaid would not try and negotiate so that you, as your brother, as the injured victim, would ever be able to get some compensation for what occurred to him. And she understood it, and I felt horrible, but that's one way that Medicare ruined a particular case. And that's why you always have to ask and consider the possibility that if the victim is elderly, if they are not working, if they are getting Medicare, it may significantly impact on the value of the damages that they have in your particular case. And that may be one of the key factors that prevents you or the referring attorney from taking on a case like that. So not only do you have to consider what do you think was done wrong and what injury did you suffer, but you have to consider what's the extent of the damages. You have to consider the statute of limitations. You have to consider whether or not this witness will be a great witness at trial. And now you think back to the original comments I made to you when I started this morning and said, I don't need to know any of this stuff. It doesn't apply to me. I don't handle medical malpractice. Well, you're right. It doesn't. But in your everyday lives, in your everyday practice, I guarantee you, you will encounter people who tell you stories of troubles, of their woes, of interactions. And now this information is going to dramatically help you understand how you can help them and decide what you need to do next. Okay? So again, I hope this discussion has been informative and educational. And again, I thank you for joining me this morning.